All right, welcome to the first of my two replay analysis, full game commentaries for Marchengard. Both of these are going to be replays on games that on my games that I've played Chen, and that's for a few reasons. The first reason is I think I can speak to the player decision-making process much stronger when I'm the player as opposed to somebody else. There's also been a bit of a Chen's not in a particularly good spot with the jungle as it is this patch, so there's not a lot of good Chen replays to watch in the pro scene. Although I would point out there is one in particular, VP's Chen game, where Lil plays Chen against, I actually don't remember against who, but it was against a Coddle. That was a very good game to watch. Yeah, I think for you as you guys as the audience, these games, my games, the pub games are going to be probably a lot more relatable, and you're gonna see a lot of an experience that's closer to your experience when you play Chen. So, there's less coordination. You see the hero kind of function individually a little bit more, so you see strengths and weaknesses, and it's really good to see those weaknesses in play. And you won't find, if I show you a perfect Chen game with on the pro scene where the team is built around him, and that's great, but what happens when you try to pick up Chen and that doesn't happen, and what happens then? So that's where pub replays are a little bit better. So this is the first of two. You can see the teams here. I think this is about a 4.4, 4.5 average, and I don't rate this as a very good average at all. I won't get into that too much, but anyway, so this game is a really good illustration of Chen's physical power, Chen's pushing power on his own, and that goes from the build all the right way through. So I think in the guide I talk about the raw physical presence a lot, and this is a good example. So I think first major item is Helm of the Dom and then a Necro. I very rarely go Necro, and that's because it's very rarely good in a game. And you can see here that's it's good this game because my team, I'm the predominant pusher. We have Jug who can push, but he's the only really other hero that does that. And the enemy team simply lacks nuking power. They lack wave clear. So that's where the opportunity for you to do this as Chen is up. Is available, and you can see this. It translates into a lot of building damage. It's really good. 9,000 building damage is not your average Chen game. Your average Chen game, a successful Chen game, will be between 4 maybe 6, and then your carries will do a lot as well. So 9's pretty big. I'll tell you to start a little bit of the basic outline of the storyline of the game, and that is where. Roaming stage, or I roam a lot in the laning stage, and it's not, astronomically successful. But hold the team together a little bit, do what needs to be done, help your team where they need to be helped. And then when you hit this timing where you have push potential and the enemy team can't stop you, absolutely exploit that timing to the full. Do everything you can to take as much map control with that power that you have, with that timing where you can push and the enemy can't stop you. To the max, and we get ourselves a good lead, and then we stagnate and flounder and throw just a little bit here and there, and then we end up pulling through, so that's nice. And we'll just get into it now. Won't go into the draft of this game too much. Pub drafts are pretty random most of the time, and I cover drafting in the guide explicitly as well. This game, I think, our third pick. And that helps a lot in terms of getting a favorable draft. If you first pick Chen a lot, you'll just have the cheap counters like CM or Coddle or Earthshaker or Mirana is a very favorite one. But yeah, third picking or something around that's just not first pick. Is pretty helpful for that. So I'm going to be doing this guide mostly through free camo. I might go into player perspective at some points. Yeah, starting the game, I've got a Bloodstone, two smokes, clarity, and an Observer Ward. So this is a pretty stock standard build. I think we probably could have killed a Lich if we use Ember's Searing Chains there. But this is just a good spot. You don't really have any obligations besides You don't really have any obligations this chance, so it's good to protect your mids bounty rune especially from the two paths. Now I'm going for a career snipe in this game, so I'm doing that with smoke and a ward. The ward helps you see the career coming a lot better, and you can see the support if he was to move up here. You can see that earlier. The smoke is really important because you see the Lich wanted to place a ward up here also, but ended up placing here. So to get across to here, undetected, smoke is absolutely necessary. As you can see, our courier has a salve. I'm expecting the OD to do the same, but he's not. You can't see the gold from the camera, but his courier is well back here. So it's just not worth the time to sit around and wait. Especially in pubs, very unpredictable what mids are gonna do. Although enemy mids are a lot more reliable in the or a lot more predictable in a lot of ways, because they'll make the more efficient plays. So I've gone over to hard camp, and I'm in time to clear it before the next spawn as well. And right now I'm weighing up, can we kill this OD? Leading with creep first, level one, go for it. OD is sitting on our high ground, going over aggressive. Get off this war stump, and with the Bloodstone, do quite just enough damage on the OD, and that's really good. It's a nice first win, and just before Jug dies too, so secure first blood. The enemy runs an offlane. It's pretty threatening. It's pretty threatening to us. Disruptor is not a good hero against aggressive lanes like this. He is very punishable. I think I haven't seen it, but I read somewhere that we saw that in the Leviathan game just the other day with EG. Leviathan punished the Disruptor pick quite hard, I think, with an Omni Knight. So anyway, I should concentrate on the Chen Guard here. What am I doing? So after securing the first blood, I've gone top, and that's to help out the where I think I can punish the Lich. Level one Lich, very weak, very weak. He's a hero that builds an advantage in the lane over time, so you can punish him early. And the way I want to do that is by pushing him away from the small camps by pulling. He's already got the pull off, which is good for him, not ideal for us, but I've stopped him from taking some last hits. Just put a ward there that I should see, but I actually click on him too late to see the ward down, but you could probably guess from the movements anyway. So take the bounty rune away from him, keep him away from the Elder Titan, although right now what I'm doing isn't too necessary because the Elder Titan's safely farming. He's not really gonna mess with mid, but I'm just zoning, seeing what he's gonna do. And I've drawn the Monkey King away from bot. This is something that you can do if you want to help your safe lane. Sometimes the best way to do that is by pressuring the enemy cores instead, not just going to the one area and dragging everybody to that one area. So right now the Elder Titan hits for a metric fuck ton, about 150, and these guys overcommit real big. My micro could have been better in all through that fight. You'll see that my micro as Chen is not particularly strong. The good thing about me with Chen is that I think I understand the hero quite well. So I make the max out of different builds and different where to be and why at various times. Now I don't go for the Spectre there, and that's because my Centaur did not have any Manifest Stomp. We probably could have right clicked him down, and that would have been worthwhile. But in my mindset, I just wanted to go continue farming, because I've spent the last minute or so just kind of wandering around with Lich, and Lich is going to get more out of that because of sacrifice. Chen, you want to secure your farm. They go on mid here, because I'm not being able to put any pressure out on the Lance. I'm not making him do anything. So it's a free opportunity to go zone out my mid. And I've thought to myself, I'm gonna go take his lane for the XP. And that's not a good thing for Chens to be doing. You want to be proactively helping your Lance, but at the end of the day, it's making the best out of the situation that you're given, or the situation that you find yourself in. So this, I want to get to level 3. Level 3 is where I get 2 creeps, and my kill potential on enemy cores and my kill threat and simply presence is much, much, much stronger. So I want to get those 2 good creeps. Satyr is one of the best. I've just inadvertently fed one to the OD, which is not a good play. See where we go from here. This is another Satyr. We get here, an opportune time to go gank a bot. I use another smoke here because I think that they've got a ward down here. It's very common if you have an aggro dual lane, that they will want to have vision control. So you see here, they don't see me come in, and we're able to get the jump on the Zeus. Unfortunately, there's a bit of a disconnect, and I also don't use my Satyr off cooldown. I get distracted, and the Zeus lives. But the monkey kind of throws himself at us, and we get him anyway, so it kind of works out. Not ideal, but it kind of works out. So in this situation with a slow and penitence, the slow from the purge from the Satyr Banisher, very, very strong ganking. You kill almost anybody without a blink. So after that, looking to secure runes for your team. I don't think the OD has a bottle, but he does have an orb of venom for some reason. But the Ember does, so it's important to secure runes, secure vision. And take away runes from the enemy team. Disruptor gets run out by the monkey a lot this game. It's actually insane. I might just pause one moment for checking my. Actually, never mind. I'll just check the audio settings. Yep, it's 15. I did a bit of some commentaries yesterday. I realized they were almost unusable because of the volume settings. Anyway, so from this position here, you're in a good position to gank from behind on both lanes. And I've seen the OD is once again out of position and sprung the trap. So there's a bit of a disconnect between stuns. I use my troll as he comes in, and Ember's. I did not think Ember would jump forward like that. But we get the kill, and that's important. I also, again, you see the micro there. I tanked with my hero a lot of the creeps, and if the OD had enough mana, he's 4 short of another arcane orb, I would have died there. So, again, another example, you don't need super strong micro, you don't need freaky micro to get the most out of this hero. I mean, to get the most, obviously, but to play a decent Chen, you don't need freaky micro. So, once again, the monkey's finding his target, going on him, and we can punish this pretty easily. Because I've helped Ember in his lane, he's super strong and he is a ganking hero. He's a hero that gets everywhere all at once. So that kind of compensates for Chen's classic lack of mobility. So it's important to enable your cores like that. Enable heroes to do things that you can't. Once again, 8 minutes. Try to secure the runes again. A lot of these few minutes, I have been gotten drawn down to this bot lane because that's where the action is. But I'm always looking to get the prize targets. The OD, killing the OD is much more valuable than killing the Zeus. And I want to do it again, but they've warded here. And as you can see, every time I move in, the OD moves back. So I know that he knows. I see that he sees, and he knows that I know. But anyway, I've walked back, and from here, they don't know if I've gone into the jungle or down a bot lane. And I go down a bot lane, keep the maximum pressure up. Even though I'm only level 4 at 8 minutes in, it's more than enough. You combo with your teammates, that's more than enough. you see this monkey just absolutely drops. And the Bloodstone, you see there, is really, really valuable against the hero-like monkey. He's actually quite squishy. He's only got a stout shield and one armor. You know, two armor from Bloodstone. He's down to minus one armor. That's, he's real squish, real squish. And I've also got a medallion. And I've, in hindsight, I don't think the medallion is actually worthwhile this game. Or at least it's worthwhile for the mana region and the active, but it's not the best choice I've ever made. But the idea behind it is there is one target in the OD or the monkey that I want to be able to focus down and kill. So in the jungle now, trying to get my army up, level 5 now, want to get 3. But yeah, that medallion, there's two heroes that I want to focus down real quick with physical damage. And it's not good because our team is actually, you know, mostly magical damage. So that's a bit of a misplay there. So again, disruptors getting absolutely just run at mercilessly, and it just is monkeys actually feeding. Same play. You got to pick up on the patterns of each individual game. You know, Chen's not a great counter ganker, but if you're in the area, and then if you're, you know, in these camps, that means you're able to respond the mid. If you're in, you know, these camps, you're able to respond the bot. So I've missed a little bit here. This is an interesting engagement, showing micro again. So again, trying to secure runes for your team is good. You want to, you want to be securing these runes, but yeah, whatever. So OD's going on. Ember's going on OD, and the overcommit's trying to get this kill. So should be able to get this OD, and I'll go back and replay this through player perspective very slowly to highlight some errors that I've made. Now the first is my two red potatoes. Only one of them has enough mana for his nuke. That would have made this much easier. Yeah, this one, yep, 40 mana shot. So that messes up my micro. I try to use the ability and it's not working. Why isn't it not working? Shit, no mana. And the second thing is I get distracted by the monkey, get out of position for the OD, and then I'll do this one more time. You can watch where I click. Watch where I click. And that is going to be on this low red potato. All my creeps and me are going to hit this red onion instead of the OD. And that's enough. See right there? About 100 damage and I'm missing an evade. I don't know how that works. But anyway. And that's enough damage for OD to survive. At this point, don't have any skills up. Don't have any mana. I don't think the... I don't think the troll has any mana or cooldown anyway. Now the Ember dies as well, and that's really bad. That's just the disruptor simply not using his kinetic field at any stage, either on OD or on the monkey. Disruptor's 4.0 this game. You get wide distributions in Australia, so it's not good to harp on particularly your teammates' mistakes. You see, I made a mistake, 700 MMR higher than him. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter, everybody makes mistakes. OD shows again. I'm thinking to myself, should just nuke him, but should make him pay. But these creeps don't have any mana, don't have anything. And that is the downside of building Ring of Bazzy and Medallion. It's enough mana for you, but your creeps, creeps 0.6 mana regen. If you're spamming these abilities to farm and to fight constantly, it's just not enough. Arcane boots or shrine usage is going to be necessary. So ideally, the disruptor would have arcane boots by 11 minutes, by 12 minutes, but he doesn't have any boots at all. Or at least I would have arcane boots. But I'm going the Helm of the Dominator. Again, going back into the jungle, to build up my army. Now I've missed, and I want to go back because I missed a very important point. After this engagement mid, I've simply gone back wanting. I want to get my level 7. That's the big power spike for me. I want to get 7 and I want to get a Helm of the Dom so we can start pushing. And to do that, I've gone back into our own jungle. Now, watch what happens top. Ember respawns and he goes and kills the Spectre. Now, that opens up a window that we should. Where there's no hero in this land. They can't defend. And we should be pushing. I'm only farming neutrals. I should probably. Like, this is where I want to be as Chen. This is where you want to be. Either to TP up or to be there preemptively. This tower, if you're here as Chen, this tower is dead. Or at least, you know, I can be pushing out mid more actively. You know, it's not good to be able to let the OD go farm neutrals. And that's just because I'm focused on level 7 and building up my army. And that's not good. I've walked down bot because I'm thinking, oh shit, I should be actively pressuring lanes. And instead of getting something valuable out of that, I'm just feeding a Cryptozeus instead. So we'll fast forward a little bit because that's the point that I wanted to make. So against this Zeus, it's hard to push in without an overwhelming force. So that's not what we have right now. And instead, I'm looking back and saying, we need to play around this Ember. He's our strongest hero on the map. I need to play around him. And that is killing the OD again. Without OD, he's their strongest hero. So without OD, they struggle to fight. I want to go back again. I should be more ready for this. This gank does not go well, and I want to pause to show you why. You see here, I have between these creeps, this guy has a slow, and this guy has a stun. My hero has a slow. What should happen is I lead with the stun and the slow. They should be in front of me, so it's least amount of time for this OD to react, especially nighttime. He can't see uphill if this creep doesn't show uphill, and I don't think it does. This is gonna show me OD player perspective. All right, fog is not. Yeah, fog's not happening for some reason. But anyway, fucking. Yeah, there we go. All right, anyway. So you'll see what happens because I don't lead. I'm kind of too hasty to do this and don't do this properly. So my hero micro isn't good as well. I'm just not using it. You'll see I commit with my hero too much. He inadvertently draws tower aggro as well, and I tank about an extra 400 damage that I shouldn't have. We kill OD anyway, but I die to the Spectre rotation. Now this is the gank that I want to be making because we take this tower afterwards. We kill their core, and with a bit better coordination, if I was to use my Sentinel Stomp or Helver Smasher for example, we could have killed the Spectre as well, and that's perfect. But a bit of a misplay there from me. And again, the monkey finds Disruptor and just runs it. Now I'm not paying attention until a little bit too late there. But it's enough to save the Disruptor. And it's enough to kill this monkey with the Ember again. So at this point, I'm very, very close to Helm of the Dom at 14 minutes with Medallion. And that's a really good pushing timing for this game. That's the timing that I want because the enemy team still can't D-push. The only D-push they truly have is Zeus with level 3 Arc Lightning right now. And that's good, but not great. It's not enough. So we've taken the top tier 1, we've taken the bot tier 1, and there's fighting and a fresh tier 1 bot. With this Helm of the Dom, that's where I'm going. This is, you know, four levels Holy Persuasion, Helm of the Dom. That's, you know, really strong individual point for Chen the hero. And with Ember, this is where we want to fight as a team. Fortunately, they do have a four staff on the OD. But you know, if you force your enemy OD to go four staff first, that's not too bad a result. So I think we try to force this tower here. I think we force this tower. We also have a catapult coming up, so it's a really good, it's a really handy timing for us. Now look what happens at this point. So a minute ago or 2 minutes ago, we didn't have this tower. A minute ago before that, we didn't have this tower. So let's start, say, from 12 minutes. Let's see where the towers. Let's see what happens with the towers, coinciding with this Helm of the Dome purchase. So waiting for our own creep wave to go up. You see the first creep wave got annihilated by the Zeus, and we know that he's going to defend now. So with Disruptor and Juggernaut, we can go on him. Disruptor's not really paying attention, but Ember is. So that's a free kill, free dead Zeus. You know, Lich Shot comes out, but it's not really enough. Monkey King TP's in, should probably die, but Disruptor panics a little bit, and that's okay. You'll see there on the side as well, the Jug popped his Healing Ward and it instantly dies. Healing Ward is super, super good with Chen pushes. It really is. You know, keeps the creep wave, it keeps your creeps, keeps everybody alive, as long as you keep it safe. I think it died within about 2 seconds. And that's something that this Jug doesn't do well this game. So it's something to keep watch on. So, tier 1 gone, immediately go for tier 2. Jug does this a lot, super aggro on defenders. Sometimes it can work. A lot of times it kind of doesn't. But the enemy team will also Rick, you know, overcommit onto you a little bit. So we get with the Ember Spirit as our main player here, where we manage to outlast them a little bit. And this time the Healing Wood survives, and it's a free tower. The enemy team is still super weak. I think at this stage they're not that far behind. They're not ahead, but they're not that far behind. So they think to themselves, we should be able to fight. But they can't. A lot of the time in pub matches, the enemy team, you know, your opponents and your teammates are going to have very little experience playing Gen, so they won't be able to gauge, you know, they won't be able to reliably know, can they go on you? Can you go on them? What's the power, what's the right play at any given situation? So, you know, for example, if your micro is good enough, your enemy heroes will simply just walk at you and die. It's actually quite good. It's great fun. So be prepared for that. Be prepared to be tested out. So right now we've taken the tier 1, we've taken the tier 2 bot, we've moved on straight to the tier 2 top, and in the space of, you know, 3 minutes, just about all their towers are gone. And this is what I'm talking about when I say finding and exploiting your timing. Finding and exploiting your timing. The enemy team doesn't have an answer to us right now. So you gotta take everything you can. You know, they give you an inch, you take a mile. You go for it. So when pushing, most of the time it's good to get wards up. This ward was against Zeus, it's really hard. So this is an example of a ward that's hard to deward, hard to know where it is. And with Chen, the cool thing you can do is use your creeps as scouting. I've got my hero safe back here. I know that they probably want to defend. Based on their previous actions, they probably want to defend. So, Resist reveals himself using creeps to scout. Using Astral to scout is really good. And this is a free tower, you just got to take it. Now, at this point here, it's good to kind of stop and take stock a little bit. So you can see from our little movements, we're thinking to ourselves, shit, we can just go high ground. It's probably worth a try for us to just go high ground here. And there's one thing I want to point out as to why that's actually a very bad idea. I talk in the guide a lot where it's a good idea if you can just to go straight high ground. And you can see on the map, a reason why is these guys are farming to get their core items, the Shadow Blade. You know, this guy's just got a Vanguard phase. He wants his Radiance. He can't do anything. You know, Lich has got nothing but Tranquils and Wand. The only one that has kind of half of anything is Zeus with stats at this stage. Doesn't even have Veil and a Full Staff. The only completed items they have is Full Staff and And Vanguard, you know, at 18 minutes, not good. So, shit, we should be able to go high ground, right? Yes. However, I actually want to move my camera here if I can, because I want to show you the gold that we have to spend. We've just got a lot of tower gold very, very, very quickly, and there's been very little downtime. Now we've amassed a 7,500 gold lead. Our heroes have a lot of gold, but you've got to ask yourself, where is this lead? What has it manifested itself into? Where is it? Is it tangible? And the answer predominantly is no, because our juggernaut has a Yasha, but it's not on his hero. Our juggernaut has a Ring of Aquila phase boots, so he's not that strong either. He's got a Yasha and 1,500 in the bank. That's 3,500 gold that he doesn't have. His net worth here is 6,500. But reality, you take away 3,500 of that, and that's 3,000. Our juggernaut has 3,000 gold, and we're pushing high ground. That's not good. Chen, I'm in a similar situation. 2,000 gold. I'm thinking to myself, I want Necro Book. 2,000 gold though. So I'm not a 6,000 net worth Chen. I'm a 4,000 net worth Chen. Ember Spirit, very similar. You know, he's got almost Battle Fury. He's got 2,000 gold left unspent. We'll go through the rest of your heroes quickly. Our Elder Titan, same again. He's 100, 200 gold from an Atos. Disruptor finally got his Arcane Boots. So he's again 200 gold from an Edelence, you know? We're stronger than the enemy, but we could be, with a little bit of pacing, a little bit of time, that much stronger than the enemy, right? So that's something to keep in mind when you watch this push. The enemy is weak, but we are not taking the most of what we do. So I'll move the cow, move this back into the corner here, and we'll go on. So the main force that's driving this push is me. I've made the play on Mike to my team. I think we should just see what happens. Go high ground, force them back. At any rate, these guys, if we push here, they can't continue farming mid. They can't continue warding. They can't continue farming bot. They have to defend. So even if we force them back, we can still back ourselves and force the enemy back into their base. Now, predictably, if you were watching the last pushes, Juggernaut and Ember are just gonna run at these guys. We should have a glimpse. We should have a glimpse to push them, to drag them back. But anyway, I won't go on to that too much. Look what happens with the healing ward here, unfortunately. So, Juggernaut commits the Omni Slash, Astral comes out, Blade Fury to finish off the Zeus, and that's good. However, the healing ward gets cleaned up, I think, by the monkey. And that's a really important, really big spell down for our push. What should really happen is get the Zeus, come back, put the healing ward down, and in a safe formation, the enemy simply can't stop us. At this point, this is a free Rax. And the healing ward down hurts a lot. You'll notice here that the Alpha Wuss has tanked the tower. In the guide, I specifically talk about this. There's a very good reason that that happens, and that is that the Alpha Wolf has 90 attack range. As you can see right there, 90 attack range, compared to the 100 attack range of the Centaur, the Conqueror, and if we show you here, a creep, 100 attack range. So he physically moves close to the tower, which draws aggro, and that's why that happens. So you've got to be careful. Now I get distracted by the I'm watching the fight right in front of me, and I don't see this till the last second, so I can save him on 20 HP, which is not quite ideal, but it's saving him is quite handy. Secures a lot of damage for the team to take tower. Now you see how quickly that tower goes down, and this is another point to stop and take stock on. We've killed their hero. We've forced out Monkey Ult, which is huge cooldown at this stage of the game. What should happen at this point is we back for 10 seconds and then we go back in. No tower, they can't stop us. We've got healing ward very soon. Yeah, we got healing ward in 30 seconds, so we can do this at a nice pace. Now, what happens instead is Disruptor stays. And we get baited into taking a fight through the Monkey King ult. That's not quite ideal. But we're still super strong. So I think Disruptor falls here to the Monkey ult. We focus the Monkey, which is good. We stop the ult. And now, with a setup from ET, we can refocus on these two heroes. We should focus one, and probably I think the OD, but we get the Spectre. And that's okay. So the Monkey King immediately buys back, and we go straight for the melee racks, which is really good. My creeps have died at this point. My creeps died, I think, to Lich ult and to... and Monkey AoE. And I think things like that. So this is when we should probably back. We forced out buyback, we forced out ults. Ember's got no mana. Jug has no cooldowns. ET has no cooldowns. We should back. We've done enough damage to back. And again, it's a lot of gold advantage we've just got, you know. ET has got a lot more gold. Do you think about the gold that we had before? We have even more gold now. So if we were to die at this point, we're feeding the enemy, we're giving the enemy so much more than they would, than they should be able to get. So unfortunately, we commit a little bit too much. The ember gets cleaned up. The jug goes aggressive on the monkey and dies in turn. I miraculously escape, and that's because the OD only has 2 levels in Astral Imprisonment right here. So we could get 4 levels in Arcane Orb, I should say. And that works in his favour. He does enough damage to the Ember, and drains his mana because of that. Anyway, so... let's see that. Yeah, they get nearly 2,000 gold just in these 2 kills. Just from killing a cause, nearly 2,000 gold. And more importantly, I think, the experience. Experience when you're behind is... as far as the comeback mechanics go, that's gold gets fed, but more experience gets fed. So that's where, you know, the Zeus will get more levels in static field, which is quite annoying for a push lineup. And that's probably the only real thing to come out of levels this game. But anyway, so right now we've done a lot of damage to them. We forced buyback on the Spectre, we forced buyback on the Monkey, and we've taken tier 3 tower top. So what I'm doing here is purchasing my Necro 1 and getting my army back. Getting your army back with Chen in the old days was a really sad thing. It took you a lot of time, but that's not really the case these days with Chen, and that is because Holy Persuasion has a 10-second cooldown. So combined with Helm of the Dom, you can get 4 creeps. You can get 4 creeps in the space of 20 seconds, right? 4 creeps in 20 seconds, and that's because at 0 seconds you get 1 Holy Persuasion and 1 Helm of the Dom. At 10 seconds you get another Holy Persuasion, and at 20 seconds you get the third Holy Persuasion. And that's really good. The problem is, and the issue always is, finding the right creeps. So for example, I've got okay creeps, not good creeps. You know, two nice creeps in the Hellbears and the Satyr, and nice creep in the Ogre Frost Mage, and I've gone a yellow creep somewhere, I think. Wait, where is... no, that wasn't a yellow creep, that was just the neutral creep. And we've just gone straight back in. These guys don't have cooldowns. I don't think the monkey has a cooldown anyway. And we just take this Rax for free. Jug, again, is just kind of walking at them. But creeps focus tower. And I overcommit my hero a little bit, and I get super punished for it with the Lich ult. You know, a long, long, slow Lich ult. 50% for... okay, 2.5 seconds, but still 50% slow. 65% slow, actually. Even more. So my hero goes in, and like last time with Disruptor, if you are not the first person to back, you are the last. So things can change really quickly. Because Jug is backing with no Blade Fury and not enough mana for Omnislash. Ember can't really sit in the front line, so we don't really... Elder Titan wants to play a backline quite fairly. Wants to play a backline role this game, so we don't really have a true front line besides my creeps. And my creeps don't have stuns, so if they run, and our Jug's not going to stop them, or Amber's not going to stop them, or Stomp's not going to stop them because it's on cooldown, then you don't have any front line. So watch what happens here. Hero goes forward because I think we're going forward, and everybody backs, and we just go back. I get cleaned up, but that emboldens the enemy to overcommit on heroes. My creeps survive. They commit. We've still got disruptor ult. We've still got Omni Slash, and that's enough to get the two cores for nothing. And we get a third kill, I think, on the Lich. So that works out. That's an okay trade. We get Rex, we lose me, we get three heroes, including their two cores, and that's okay. And it was really important that we've used that timing where they just bought back. You know, Spectre can't buy back again. Monkey King can't buy back again. And we take that Rax while it's vulnerable. Because now, as you can see already, this top lane is going to push in, and it's going to create problem for the Dire that they're never going to get over. If they don't have the team for clearing my creeps. They don't have the team for clearing my creeps, and they don't have the team certainly for clearing super creeps. So I've tested faith in my creeps back to me, and trying to push lanes and rebuild my army. Again, trying to rebuild army. So we've taken their Rax, and the next objective logically is this Roshan. Fortunately, what'll happen a lot when you're taking a lead or sort of pushing as Chen is your team, or you will get baited into awkward split pushing engagements. So I'm still pushing out bot lane and trying to build my army. They're telling my team, get back, it's not a worthwhile fight. And what's happened here is the Elder Titan has baited in the Ember, who has gone in and blinked out, which has in turn baited in the Disruptor and Jug, and they've just died. Which I think means that we lose this T1 tower, and that's not really good. So when you're split pushing as Chen, when you're not having everybody grouped up, this kind of thing is likely to happen a lot of the time. So beware of that, don't flame. Just try to prepare your team. Play with them. Now Ember doesn't want to go in there because he doesn't have a fire room available. And the enemy has to back at this point. He shouldn't be afraid because the enemy has to back. And they have to back because they have to deal with top lane, and they want to deal with the bot lane that I've just pushed in. And it works out that we don't get either of these two kills, which is quite sad. We don't have detection for the monkey, and nor I or the Ember committed for the Lich. So what this does enable us to do, however, is to take this Roshan. So I've got an okay creep army again. And with the Medallion is particularly good at taking this Roshan. So at four times, goes in about 30 something seconds maybe. It's okay, considering how bad our team in general is, it's okay. So right now we've got Aegis on Jug, and I'm very close to Necro 3, so that's the timing, I think, that we should go for, when Jug has his offensive item. He's got Manta, which is nice, but his offensive item is probably more important, so it's just about making the most of the map. We're farming, you know, a lot of different areas right now. Farming all three. And this is doable because top lane is constantly pushing in. The Spectre isn't actually an okay hero to be able to do that with one lane because he's got Haunt to immediately join the fight. But that's really only for one lane. Now I've got the Necro 3, which is a lot of physical power. I don't know why this ward is still showing the blue. The replay's buggy, man. Replay's a buggy. It's still showing the ward vision from before. Now I'll pull back a little bit because I've just decided walking up, telling my team, we're going to split push this one. I saw what happened last time. Our team fighting is pretty awkward. We're going to split push this one. So team goes in, Juggernaut once again, Omni slashes, and they retreat the shrine, taking back all the damage. We lose Aegis for no heroes and Disruptor. But this is actually okay because Jug has drawn all of their attention up there, and I am taking Bot Rex. The monkey's tried to defend, and he's gotten shrecked. This is just what you have to do. If you can't or you don't want to fight, or you don't trust your team to be able to fight, having this raw power is enough. Is enough sometimes just to force the objective anyway. On a different lane. Now, I've gotten too confident. I'll show you that push from my perspective actually. Just to show. So I immediately walked across here. At the same time as Jug is going in, tower at full HP, making sure that the Elfwolf doesn't get tower aggro. You can see how quickly this tower just drops between all these creeps. The Alpha Wolf is particularly useful here. And with the Necro Vision, I can see this guy coming, and he just pops. I don't even use the mana burn. I don't even use the stomp. I do use the thunderclap, but the raw physical attacks of the creeps is enough. So I walk up here in my emboldened state. I'm nuking the Lich, which is not worth, and killing my creeps and killing my hero for it. Cleaned up by the Spectre of the OD. And that's not really worth it. Again, that's another point where I should have said, I've got the objective. Now it's time to back. Secure our lead. We worked up to a 12k gold lead now, which is really good. But yeah, Jug has also been emboldened and decided to man fight. So the gold lead is back to 10 now. That one kill was like 2k gold. So at any rate, this is still 1,000 damage on this tower and a full half a lane of racks, and most importantly the melee racks. So at this point I'll do a little bit of shit talking actually, but that's all in the nature of good fun. I like a bit of banter in games. So at this point, obviously, in the short term, look to rebuild your army so you can do anything like to again. And then ask yourself the question, what do I need to get this final Rax? Because that's what's going to win this game. We're not going to split push, but it's not feasible to split push into the tier 4s. We've already taken the side Rax, so this mid Rax needs to fall for us to win the game. Or we need to kill all the heroes or whatever. Whatever needs to happen to get this mid Rax to win the game. So I'm going, my two options as Chen here are to... I'll take a moment to point out here. Yeah, this is a full triple stack. This is a full triple stack, and that was done by Lich in the laning stage. But the point was, his hero is not a hero that can farm stacks like that. A Sven, sure. Terrorblade, sure. Spectre, you can't do it. So please don't do that to your safe lane carry. I'm sure Spectre would have more farm if he could actually farm that camp. Anyway, so. The point I was talking about was, as Chen, asking yourself the question, what do I need to do to take this Rax? And at this point, I'm the hero that's doing the damage to take that Rax. So what do I need? And basically, there's two options. From this point, with this build, there's two options. And that is Pipe, or that is Ags. To make your creeps that you have tankier, or to make your creeps bigger and tankier and give them a stronger set of buffs. My Elder Titan has actually gone pipe this game, so that kind of rules out pipe for me, leaving Ags. Now I think at this point I've got about 2 or 3 thousand gold, so farming with this build is probably your strongest farming build. You just do so much damage, and you've got reasonable mobility. So with the two camps. With the two Raxes that we've taken, the enemy can't really do anything to us. The game is completely under our control and under our tempo. So we can farm for any set of items that we want. And this is something your team won't necessarily share your patience here. In pubs, teams might see this and say, just go again. Just go again. But that's if you, the price of failure in these games is quite high, especially against a team that scales. So it's important not to give them the chance if you can. Anyway, so I've got to fast forward here. I've talked about the points that I really wanted to. Yeah, I said before, these are the things that can happen. Ember Spirit's farming super, super aggressively for very little reason. And he just kind of dies. But that's okay. That's just a good example of what can happen. Your team will get complacent with this kind of lead. And at this point, it's interesting to note that the way that I'm playing is much more like a 3. You know, the Elder Titan doesn't have the same farming capacity. And in ideal Chen games, this is what will happen. Chen is actually a very strong, not rapid farming hero, but he can farm quite well if you put out the pressure as well. So waiting for the next Roshan and waiting for Ags is our timing. We've got the pipe, you know, we can just hit this building and we should be fine. So I should take the Thunderhide. Thunderhide for War Drums is a really good aura. Yeah, I do actually. There's another point where I take the Thunderhide, where I don't take the Thunderhide when I should. So I should tell you already that this push isn't very successful. So ideally what I want is, I'm looking for, is these creeps. This golem here for the bonus HP. That would make our Juggernaut an extra, give him an extra 300 HP. And, you know, similar for ET, similar for me. I've actually got more HP, 400 HP than the Juggernaut. Now we go, gonna talk about this fight as it happens actually. Because the similar themes happen. Juggernaut is a 4.8 player in this game. But he doesn't use critical thinking or learn very well. So he does the same kind of thing. Monkey King pops his ult. And we don't want to fight into that. Blade Fury spin back should happen. But he decided he's got Aegis. And there's no creeps for a couple of seconds. So he wants to go in. I've only got my one Thunderhide to buff him. And the rest standing back safely. So that Zeus can't kill them. Thunderhide's not going to die to Zeus. Not going to die to Monkey Ult. Not going to die to OD. But Ember tanks a lot of damage from the... from the Monkey King ult. Juggernaut tanks a lot of damage. And this is really awkward. We're completely zoned by the Monkey King ult. The Juggernaut is completely zoned on the other side, leaving him to 1v5. You know, especially into the Nimbus. Whoa, it's not good. Not good. Not good. So Lich ult has used to zone. I'm trying to isolate my creeps with the pipe active. So you know the disruptor can get away. And I can get away. And this is where Monkey King ult is fading out. And it's a replay bug that is still going. It's not still going. And we've still got cheese on Juggernaut. And he miraculously, spoiler, miraculously gets it off with the blade spin. We've taken Rax, but the Juggernaut's super weak now. And the Ember Spirit is super weak. And the ET has no mana. So we should be backing up, and the enemy knows this and goes after us. So this is a really awkward and weak spot for us. The Spectre commits onto me, and the Spectre commits on the Disruptor, but he just dies for, I think it's the active from, yeah, the active from the Necrobook actually gets, sorry, not the active, the last will from the Necrobook actually cleans him up. But, yeah, the OD, the Monkey King, with both of them having BKB, it's not good for us. And that is a push and an Aegis and a cheese completely wasted. So that's all things not to do. All things not to do. I wanna point out that this could be, if I'm watching closely as Chen, or if I'm watching my teammates closely, I should be able to see in foresight and make the call for Juggernaut to back. And that's doing it for the Ember Spirit. If the Ember Spirit is having no mana, you know, if your playmaking hero is not able to fight, you've got to be able to see that And even if he's not saying it himself, that's the things you got to be looking for. As Chen, that's hard because you're already microing, taking care of five heroes. So to do that with looking at the enemy team with another five heroes and looking at that your own team with another four heroes, it's asking a bit much, but that's the thing that you want to be trying to do. If you're an omniscient and if you're an omniscient being, then that's what you should be able to see. But we're only mere mortals, only mere humans. Anyway, so fast forward through that. And looking at what we do have from this, yeah, huge 4,000, 4,000 gold swing, huge penalty that we've lost. And you know, with the this is most of Spectre's Yasha or Mantanelle, and that's a big plus for him. At 37 minutes, he should have his radiance by now. But anyway, so you can see the lead back to 8K from 15,000. Yeah, we do that again, it's back to zero. Yeah. The price of failure in these bushes is pretty high. But the good thing is, we've taken that tier 3, even though it was only 300 damage left on it. But we've still got the two Lands of Rax, and they are worth gold against teams that don't have strong wave clear. So for me, I've now chosen to upgrade to the Vlads to commit to this physical damage push, especially after that. It's certain in my mind that I am the hero that needs to take the building. I'm the hero that needs to push it because the Juggernaut, every chance he's gotten, has been to ignore the racks and to go further in. To ignore the racks and to go further in. To ignore the racks and dive in Omni Slash. And I think it's on a side note, using Omni Slash like that is actually really, really bad because it's also you're kind of it's a defensive ability, and then it's like Sleight of Fist. You cannot be hit during it. So to use it super aggressively like that is not particularly good. Juggernaut does, I'll give him credit for this, he builds the right item in BKB because he needs it to fight these heroes into especially OD, and it saves his ass right here. So what that last fight, I'll draw it back, what this last fight gave the enemy is a chance to put good wards down, and that's what shows the ET here and results in a free kill. The Juggernaut goes in again. He doesn't seem to understand how Azrael works against Omni Slash. But it means that Disruptor gets baited in, and Juggernaut gets baited in as well. I'm seeing this, I don't want any part of it, but I've realized I can save this Jug. He's going to survive a little bit longer, but I can save this Jug. The Spectre wants to go on me again, but he's a puss and doesn't want to commit quite smartly into the Necro and the big creeps. This creep in particular will shred Spectre. He's only got 10 armor, all of that's natural. So the ET aura as well is gonna completely remove it. Anyway, so I'm trying to build my army. We should get that map control back and find an opportune time to go high ground. Ideally, what we should do in this situation is kill them outside base. Sieging is very difficult for us because we just don't have the understanding to do it or the coordination to do it. So we should be looking to pick off as the enemy is put under various split push pressures, you know. So the creeps that I'm looking out for are the Black Dragon. I really want the Black Dragon, the Golem, and this creep. I think, yeah, this is the point where I don't take this creep, where I should take this creep. The War Drums aura is super good, boys. Super good. 15% damage increase, half the wolf, 15%, 15 attack speed, which is the same as. Fucking click the damn thing. It's the same as his big red onion. There we go. Swiftness aura, 15. So 30 between them. And an extra 3 armor, which is the Wild Wing aura from the Black Dragon. But the Black Dragon is really good for this spell here, the Fireball. Fireball is your gods, is like the one of the best things available to Chen because an entire creep wave we'll just die. 85 damage per second is, 20 damage stronger than the Radiant's damage per second. More than that, 25 stronger. So that just enables you to push as we push so much faster. Now, this is the important penultimate fight. We've got a ward here because we're dominating the map. And we see this. So I've now got my, the creeps that I want. And are looking to go and push. The enemy team is looking to get a little bit extra farm. And we can see as this goes on. I think Ember Spirit's invisible, yeah. Ember Spirit's invisible, yeah. They go on the jug or the other gun. Monkey King ult comes, completely zones the team. That's really hard for us to fight. Jug Omni Slashes, and BKB means that he can run away. But look at this. I've decided, fuck that, I don't want to fight. This is what's going to save the game for us, or we're going to win the game for us. And look what happens. Lich TP's back. Monkey King runs back. Zeus runs back. And what happens is the OD is left completely isolated, and we kill him without buyback. That's the important thing. So to replay that again, in the space of a couple of seconds, by me pushing in and threatening the buildings, OD has gone from a space where it's 4-on-1, they want to kill this juggernaut. They want to kill 5-on-1 actually. They want to kill the disruptor which they have, and the Ember Spirit which they have, to everybody around him is just gone. That Atos makes her very sad. Very sad OD. Spectre TP is out, Lich TP is out, everybody's gone. Now my creeps, a lot of my creeps get Lich altered, they take a lot of damage from the Boundless Strike, so Necrobook's down, small creeps down, but the two Ancient creeps survive, and that's really good. This is the benefit of Ancient creeps. I have an ult just to secure the Ancient creeps, because they're that valuable to me. The Golem especially, that valuable to me. And this is the point, this is the really good point for us, because the OD does not have buyback. This is the pick-off that we needed. We don't want a siege, this is a pick-off that we needed. So I've got a little wolf from the side just then, very luckily. And the Spectre has overcommitted, because the OD, he's not nearly as strong without the OD. The OD is a perfect hero to take. Juggernaut doesn't have much. The Ember Spirit has had to go back to base. The guy that's forcing this push at this point is still me. Still me, but the Ember Spirit's back now. And this is where Spectre, with no buyback, is doing silly things. Not really able to judge what he can do. He's got Penitence on him. He's got Medallion on him. He's got ET Aura on him. He dies, man. He just gets eviscerated. One hit from that ET, man. I've got to see that in super, super slow-mo. Super, super slow-mo. Even with Ice Armor. Even with Ice Armor. Penitence, 36% amp. Medallion, minus 7 armor. He's been purged, so no Lich armor now. And 100% natural aura. He's on a lot of minus armor right now. Minus 7 armor. Whoo! He's gone. He's gone, boys. And that's game. That's buyback Spectre. That's no buyback OD. And that's game. So we'll fast forward here. I think I get some nice cleanup kills, which is nice. Yeah, apparently I got that kill on Spectre. It wasn't the ET. But, it's still satisfying. Alright. So that covers a lot of the things that I wanted to talk about from this game. You saw Chen roam around, try to secure lanes. Right, our safe lane was under a lot of pressure this game. Was able to impact mid, was able to do a little bit, but I was not able to impact top lane very much at all. But where my impact came from this game was finding that timing with the Helm of the Dom and the Medallion at 14 or so minutes, and in that time we took pretty much from 12 to 18 minutes we thought every single outer tower, one tower a minute. As it's not quite Deathball, but it was really strong. And from there, you saw the problem of sieging, and sieging is hard. Sieging is hard. You're, yeah, it's tricky. It's I make it out to be worse than it is, but my point is, things will happen that you don't see coming. Or maybe if you expect the worst, then you will see it coming. But yeah. So that's that game. That I think really highlights the strengths of a physical damage based build, which is really what this is: physical damage based build and some buffs, and physical damage and aura is what I'd say. Aura based build. You know, between the Helm of the Dom aura, the Necrobook, they've got auras. The Vlad's aura. Each creep having auras. You're doing your creeps almost have double damage each. It's actually insane. So yeah. 9,000 building damage will, if you get 9,000 building damage in games, you win games. That's how it works. So I was a lot more of a core this game. You'll see the interaction in a lot of offlaners. Chen works really well with offlaners who want to be active. Don't necessarily want to farm too much because it opens up space for you to farm and it opens up space for you to split push. So if you have a clockwork, let's say, who doesn't want to sit in lane and push that lane, you as Chen can go and sit in lane and push that lane, and that's a good example, and it makes space for that clockwork to gank. So that's a nice interaction. ET doesn't farm too much in this game. So it's a similar kind of scenario. Yeah, that's everything that I wanted to cover in this video. I hope it wasn't too long. I hope it was enjoyable. Thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoy the guide. Cheers.